So we're going to show that this function f, which is a degree 6 polynomial, is omega of n to the 6. And in this example, some of the lower order terms, which are the terms with exponents less than 6, have negative coefficients. So according to the definition of omega, we need to find positive constants n sub 0 and c, such that for any n greater than or equal to n sub 0, the value of the function f is greater than or equal to c times n to the 6. In order to simplify this expression, we're going to start out by dropping the lower order terms with positive coefficients. And in this case, we only have 1, which is the 4 times n cubed term. Since n sub 0 is going to be positive, we know that any value of n that we plug into the expression is also going to be positive. And therefore, this 4 times n cubed term is going to be positive. So the only difference between these two expressions is that the expression on the left includes the 4 times n cubed term, and the expression on the right does not include the 4 times n cubed term. Therefore, the expression on the right is less than or equal to the expression on the left. If we're able to lower bound the expression on the right by c times n to the 6, then we'll know that the original value of the function f is also at least c times n to the 6. So we need to pick constants n sub 0 and c and show that this expression, 3 n to the 6 minus 6 n to the 5th minus 4 n squared minus 7, is greater than or equal to c times n to the 6. Intuitively, the reason that the function f is omega of n to the 6 is that for large n, the leading n to the 6 term dominates the rest of the expression. The fact that the n to the 6 term has at least one more factor of n than any of the low-order terms makes the leading term much larger for large values of n, regardless of the values of the constant coefficients. Of course, we need to make this intuition concrete mathematically. And there are many ways to pick the constants c and n sub 0. We're going to start by choosing c equal to 3 divided by 2, which is chosen to be half of the coefficient of the leading term. So we're going to think of dividing the leading term into two terms, each with a coefficient of 3 over 2. The first term is equal to the lower bound that we're trying to show. So it remains to show that the second high order term, along with all of the other low order terms, is greater than or equal to 0. If we can show that this expression is greater than or equal to 0, then we'll have proven the inequality that we need to show. So we need to pick a value for n sub 0 so that for any n greater than or equal to n sub 0, this expression here is greater than or equal to 0. Now the expression is a little complicated because there are a lot of terms with different coefficients. So I'm going to estimate the function by a simpler function. The important thing is that since I'm trying to lower bound this expression, I need to make sure that my estimate is a lower bound on the original expression. Now the way I'm going to lower bound this expression is by taking each low order term and replacing its exponent by 5. And 5 is chosen because it's the highest exponent of any of the low order terms. So now all of the low order terms have an exponent of 5. So in order to do this lower bound, we have to make sure that n is greater than or equal to 1. So we're going to make sure and choose a value of n sub 0 that's at least 1. And if n is greater than or equal to 1, then n squared is less than or equal to n to the 5th. Now I can take this inequality and multiply both sides by minus 4. And when you multiply by a negative number, the inequality changes directions. So we've shown that this minus 4n squared term is greater than or equal to the minus n to the 5th term on the right-hand side. Using a similar argument, we can show that the minus 7 term on the left is greater than or equal to the minus 7 times n to the 5th term on the right. So now I have a much simpler expression, and I can consolidate all the n to the 5th terms into a single term that's minus 17 times n to the 5th. Note that the 17 is the sum of the absolute values of all of the negative coefficients in the original function. So now we can factor out an n to the 5th term. And since we know that n is going to be positive, we know that this n to the 5th term is going to be positive. So now we just have to make sure and pick a value of n, or n sub 0, that guarantees that this second expression, 3/2 times n minus 17, is greater than or equal to 0. So now we can solve for the right value of n sub 0. We want 3 times n minus 17 to be greater than or equal to 0, and that inequality holds if and only if n is greater than 2 times 17 divided by 3. So this is the value that we select for n sub 0. 17 is the sum of the absolute values of the negative coefficients in the function f, and 3 is the coefficient of the leading term in f. Now we've shown here how we derive the values of n sub 0 and c, but a proof is going to go in the reverse direction. A proof is going to start with the assumption that n is greater than or equal to this value 2 times 17 divided by 3, and we'll follow each of these steps in the reverse direction, and we'll end up with the inequality that the value of the function n is greater than or equal to 3/2 times n to the 6 for n greater than or equal to n sub 0.